we'll discuss about some of the important topics of electricity. In the classes, we have discussed about what is electricity, what are its uses. Then we have discussed about charge, what was charge and what were its properties. Thereafter, we discussed about an important element, entity of electricity, that is an electric current. An electric current that was represented by I. And mathematically, we write it as I is equal to Q upon T, where Q is charge and this is I is time. In the definition, we can call it as electric current is the flow of charges. This portion we have already discussed during the class OS. Today we will discuss about what is the direction of the current. If we talk about the direction of the current, in the, you can say, 17th century, we were known to only two types of charges. That was positive and negative charges. Only two types of charges were known, but electrons were known later on. They came into existence later on. So now we study that the electric current is the flow of electrons, but that time electrons were not known. So we call the electric current as the flow of positive charges. So when electrons were discovered, the definition of the electric current becomes the flow of electrons. So, flow of positive charges is called as conventional current. Electric current, when electrons were discovered by J.J. Thomson, the definition of the current becomes flow of negative charges. That is flow of electrons. In short, we can say the direction of the conventional current is in the opposite as that of the electric current. We can represent it as suppose this is the direction of conventional current and this will be the direction of electric current. We have discussed about the unit of electric current. SI unit of charge is coulomb and that of time is second. That is coulomb second inverse. This coulomb second inverse is also called as ampere. And this is in the honor of the scientist André Marie Ampere. Now the term is ampere. We'll come to know what is 1 ampere. One ampere is equal to, we'll put charge as 1 coulomb and time is 1 second. Now we'll look into the definition of 1 ampere. We'll put charge as 1 coulomb and time as 1 second. So we'll say 1 ampere will be the current when the charge of 1 coulomb will flow through a cross sectional area of a conductor in 1 second. This is called as 1 ampere. This ampere is a larger unit of electric current. So we use many other units of electric current which are small. That is milliampere. It is equal to 10 raised to power minus 3 amperes, and microampere, which is equal to 10 raised to power minus 6 ampere. Now our next topic is electric potential. Our next topic is electric potential. Now, what is electric potential? Let us consider a conductor. Let us consider we are having a charge Q. This charge Q is at infinity from any of the points near the conductor. Now the question arises is, what is the infinity point? Infinity point means where the influence of this charge will be negligible. The influence of this charge will be negligible, means there will be no force of attraction between this charge and the charges of the body. So this electric potential is actually the amount of work done which is done by an electric circuit to bring that charge from infinity to a point. Means the work done by an electric circuit to bring a charge from infinity to a point is called as electric potential. This is electric potential, amount of work done in bringing a unit positive charge from infinity to a point. We represent electric potential by V. We can write it as W upon Q. This W is the work done, whereas Q is charge. We can say work done to charge. Electric potential is amount of work done by charge. If we move into its unit, work done, it's in joules, SI unit, and that of charge is coulomb. This is joule coulomb inverse. This joule coulomb inverse is also called as volt. Next we will discuss about electric potential difference, which we usually called voltage. Again, we'll take a conductor. We are having a charge at point Q. Suppose we have to bring this charge Q from point B to A. So the amount of work done in bringing this unit positive charge from B to A is called as electric potential difference or voltage. from one point to another. The only difference between electric potential and electric potential difference is there we were having infinity and here we are having a charge at a particular point where the influence of other charges can be experienced. If we talk about the unit, we have already written V is equal to W upon Q, that is V is equal to joule upon coulomb. This is joule coulomb inverse, or we write it as volt. So if someone asks what is 1 volt, 1 volt will put joule as 1 coulomb, joule work done as 1 joule and charge as 1 coulomb. Work done 1 joule, charge 1 coulomb. So 1 volt is when the work done of 1 joule is done in bringing a charge of 1 coulomb from one point to another, we called voltage as 1 volt. Now our next topic is Ohm's law. This is one of the most important topic of this chapter from examination point of view also. So first, this Ohm's law. This Ohm's law was given by Sir George Simon Ohm. He was a physicist. He gave this law in the year 1827. This particular Ohm's law, this Ohm's law is applicable to ohmic conductor only. This Ohm law is applicable to ohmic conductors only. It is not applicable to non ohmic conductors. Now the question is, what are ohmic conductors and what are non-ohmic conductors? Ohmic conductors are those which obeys Ohm's law, and non-ohmic conductors are those which doesn't obey Ohm's law. Now what is the statement of Ohm's law? Keeping the physical conditions constant. Our physical conditions include temperature of a conductor, pressure, etc. Keeping the physical conditions constant, the current flowing through a conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference applied across the ends of the conductor. This potential difference, it is always measured across the conductor. So the statement is, keeping the physical conditions constant, the current flowing through the conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference applied across the ends of the conductor. Mathematically we can express it as I is directly proportional to V, or we can write it as V is directly proportional to I. We have written V is directly proportional to I. As we know, we don't keep this proportionality sign. We remove it by adding a constant, that is R. We can write it as V is equal to I R, where R is constant of proportionality or we write it as resistance. From here we can deduce other relations as V is equal to I R. We can write I is equal to V upon R. This is another relation. Next, R is equal to V upon I. This R is constant, means V upon I will remain constant. If we look into the unit of this resistance, the unit of resistance is V is volt. As a unit of voltage is volt, and that of current is ampere. Means volt ampere inverse. This volt ampere inverse is also called as ohm. So as a unit of resistance is ohm, means resistance is measured in ohms. We'll look into some important symbols. First one is this symbol. This symbol is of resistance. This is voltmeter. Voltmeter is used to measure voltage. We are having it at home also. This is ammeter. This is used to measure the current in the conductor. This is galvanometer. This galvanometer measures the presence of electric current in the circuit. This is the symbol of bulb. This is the symbol of cell, and the combination of cells is called as battery. Then next one we have is variable resistance. This is variable resistance. Suppose we have a joint in the wires, we represent it as this joint in wire. If two wires crosses each other and if there is no joint, wire without joint. There are some conventions. This voltmeter, this is always connected parallelly, whereas this ammeter, this is always connected in series. So next we'll move on to its circuit diagram. This is the circuit diagram of Ohm's law. This is voltmeter. This is ammeter. This is resistance. This is variable resistance, also known as rheostat. This one is cell or battery, and this one is key. This is how we connect Ohm's law. Now the next thing is experimental verification of Ohm's law. This experimental verification, we do it by doing an experiment. We'll be doing it as a practical in laboratory. What we have to do is we have to connect all these substances according to the diagram. When we will connect these this voltmeter parallelly to this resistance, and ammeter is in series with this resistance, and this variable resistance is also connected in series with resistance. When we will connect all this and using a battery, we can add a switch for our safety for on or off. When we will connect this circuit, keeping the voltage constant, we'll get the measurement of electric current, and we'll get the measurement of voltage, and we can measure voltage from voltmeter and electric current from ammeter. Suppose our voltage was 2 volt and our current was 4. Again, next our voltage was 3, current was 6, voltage was 4, current was 8, voltage was 5 and current was 10. We can find the ratio. You know R is equal to V upon I. We'll get 2 upon 4. 0.5, here also 0.5, means we are getting a constant value for the resistance. If we draw graph between V and I, we'll get a straight lines. So today we have discussed about electric potential, and electric potential difference or voltage. Next, we discussed about Ohm's law, its statement, its circuit diagram, various symbols that are used, and its experimental verification. Which we'll be doing practically. One thing we have to remember is, this is a note, current always flows from the region of higher potential to the region of lower potential. Means, in an electric circuit, current flows from positive end to negative end, whereas in a battery, current flows from negative to positive.